It was the time of primal chaos, a time when the earth was new and undefined. Arid deserts and black bubbling volcanoes covered by swirling clouds of gases scarred the grim visage of the newborn world. It was, as yet, the time of the great void. Then, into that oblivion, from the dull, dark heavens there came a trickle of water. First one drop, then another and another, until finally there gushed a mighty torrent down upon the earth. The divine waters from heaven flooded downwards, soaked into the arid dirt, cooled the volcanoes which turned into grey granite mountains, and life began to spring forth across the earth. The dark reddened skies grew light and blue. From the darkened soil there grew a tree, tall and strong. Danu, the divine waters from the heaven, nurtured and cherished this great tree, which became the sacred oak named Bileh. Of the conjugation of Danu and Bileh, there dropped two giant acorns. The first acorn was male, and from it sprang the Dagda, the good god. The second seed was female, and from there emerged Brigantu, or Brigid, the exalted one. And the Dagda and Brigid gazed upon one another in wonder, for it was their task to wrest order from the primal chaos, and to the people of the earth with the divine children of Danu, the mother goddess whose divine waters had given them life. So there, by the divine waters of Danu, from where those waters rose and flooded through the now fertile green valleys of the earth, eastward towards the distant sea, the Dagda and Brigid settled. They called the great course of eastward rushing water after their mother goddess, which is Danavius, whose children still know it as the mighty Danube. And four great bright cities they built there on its broad banks, in which the children of Danu would live and thrive. The four cities were Phileas, Gorias, Phineas, and Murias. The Dagda became their father, thus humankind call him the father of gods. And Brigid became the wise one, exalted in learning, and much did she imbibe from the mighty Danu and from Bileh, the sacred oak. She was hailed as the mother of healing, of craftsmanship, and of poetry. Indeed, she excelled in all knowledge. She showed her children that true wisdom was only to be garnered from the feet of Danu, the mother goddess, and so only to be found at the water's edge. Those who gathered such knowledge and also paid deference to Bileh, the sacred oak, because they were not allowed to speak his holy name. They called the oak Drayu, and those who learned such knowledge were said to possess oak Dru, knowledge Vid, and therefore they were known as Druids. This knowledge of the children of Danu grew, and each of their four great cities prospered. In Phaleas they held a sacred stone called the Lia Fael, or Stone of Destiny, which when a righteous ruler set foot upon it, would shout with joy. In Gorias, where Urias of the noble nature dwelt, they held a mighty sword called the Retaliator, fashioned before the time of the gods themselves, and which Urias passed to Lu Lamfarda, who became the greatest warrior among the gods. In Phineas they held a magic spear called the Red Javelin, which once cast would find its enemy no matter where he hid. And in Murias they held the Cauldron of Plenty, from which the Dagda could feed entire nations, and it would still not be emptied. For many eons the children of Danu grew and prospered in their beautiful cities. Then one day the Dagda, the father of gods, and Brigid, the exalted one, called their children to them. You have tarried here long enough. The earth needs to be peopled and needs your wisdom to advise and direct them, so that they may live lives of virtue and merit. Our mother Danu has directed you to move towards the place where the bright sun vanishes each evening. Why should we go there? Demanded Nuadu, the favorite son of the Dagda. Because it is your destiny, replied Brigid, and you, Nuada, shall lead your brothers and sisters, and their children, and the land that you will come to will be called Insafar, the island of destiny. There you will abide until your destiny is fulfilled. If it's our destiny, said another of the Dagda's sons, named Ogma, then we shall accept it. Ogma was the most handsome of all the children of Danu, for his long curly hair, the rays of the sun shone, and he was called Ogma Grian Amech, of the sunny continent. To him fell the gift of honeyed words, of poetry, and of languages, and he it was who devised how men could write in the form of calligraphy, which was named after him as Ogham. Brigid smiled at her eager children. I am allowed to give you one word of warning. When you reach Innisfail, you will find another people who already claim the island of destiny as their own. They are the children of Domnu, who is the sister of our mother Danu. But beware, for Domnu is not as Danu, for each sister is the inverse of the other, as winter is to summer. Then, Nuada said, should we not take something to defend ourselves with, lest the children of Domnu fight us for possession of the Isle of Destiny? The Dagda gazed at them kindly, and replied, you may take the four great treasures of the cities, Phalias, Gorias, Phineas, and Murias. The children of Danu took the treasures, and they went to the mountains, overlooking the headwaters of the Danavus, the divine waters from heaven, and ascended in a great cloud which bore them westward to the Isle of Destiny. Among them were three beautiful young sisters, who were the wives of the sons of Ogma. Their names were Banba, Folta, and Ir. And each sister nurtured an ambition that this new land, the Isle of Destiny, would one day be named after her. Night wrapped her darkened mantle over Maeg Turandiv, which is called the Plain of Towers, which lay in the west of the Isle of Destiny. On each side of the great plain separated by the river Unias, myriads of small campfires glowed in the gloom. Two armies had gathered for combat. 7 years had passed since the children of Danu had landed in their cloud on the shores of the Isle of Destiny. They had fought initially with a strange race of people called the Furbolg, who challenged their right to rule in the Island of Destiny. These they had met at the pass of Balagatan, and the conflict went on for 4 days. And in that conflict, there came forth a champion of the Furbolg named Sreng, who challenged Nurda, the leader of the children of Danu, to single combat. So strong and mighty was Sreng that with one sweep of his great sword he cut off Nuada's right hand. But the Fulborg and their king, Echondev, were defeated and dispersed. Dian Kech, the god of all physicians, came to Nuada after the battle and fashioned him an artificial hand made of silver, so strong and subtle that it was little different from the real hand. Thus did Nuada receive his full name, Nuada Argenta Lamp of the Silver Hand. Because he was maimed, the other children of Danu had to choose another to be their leader, for they had been told by Brigid that no one with a blemish must be allowed to rule them. In choosing a new leader, they made a disastrous choice. As an act of coalition between themselves and the children of the Domnu, they chose Bres, son of Eltha, king of the children of Domnu, who were known as the Fomori, and of those who dwelt beneath the sea. And to further coincide with the alliance, the Anchet married Athene, the daughter of the foremost Fomori warrior named Balor of the One Eye. And the condition was that if Bres did anything which displeased the children of Danu, then he would abdicate and depart in peace. Those years marked a period of strife. Bres, being a Fomori, refused to keep his word and began to lay heavy burdens on the children of Danu. For a while, Bres and the children of Domnu, the children of darkness and evil, dominated the land, and the children of Danu, the children of light and goodness, they were helpless and as slaves. And then finally Maech, the son of Dian Shech, aided by his sister, the beautiful Ermid, fashioned a new hand of flesh and bone for Nuadr. His hand replaced the Anshach's silver one, and now, without blemish, Nuadr claimed leadership of the children of Danu once again. So jealous was the Anshach of his son's achievement that he slew Mike. But that is for another story. Nuadr chased Bres back to the land of the Fomori, where Bres demanded that Elther, his father, provide him with an army to punish the children of Danu. Thus, on the plain where the ancient megaliths stood, thrusting their dark granite skyward, the plain of towers, on the evening of the Feast of Samhain, the children of Danu faced the children of Domnu in battle. At dawn, the battle commenced. Combat broke out all along the lines as Nuadr led his warriors, both male and female, across to the warriors of Bres and his Fomori. Across the battlefield, the Morrigan, Queen of Battles, with her sisters, Bave the Crow, Naaman the Venomous, and Fee the Hateful, rushed hither and thither with their wailing cries which drove mortals to despair and death. As time passed, Indech, a Fomori warrior, approached Bres and pointed out that wherever the children of Danu were slain, or their weapons broken or destroyed, they would be carried from the field, and shortly after would appear alive and well with their weapons intact. Bres summoned his son, Nuadr, to ride by his side, and ordered him to discover the cause of the endless supply of weapons. And he summoned the sons of Indech, a warrior named Octrilliach, to discover how the children of Danu, once slain, could come alive again. Disguising himself as one of the children of Danu, Rudan went behind the lines of warriors and came across Bivanu, god of smiths, who had set up a forge alongside the plain of towers. With Gorbanu was Luchthain, the god of carpenters, and Cridan, the god of bronze workers. As each broken weapon was handed to Gorbanu, the smith god gave it three blows of his hammer, which forged the head. Luchthain gave the wood three blows of his axe, and the shaft was formed. Then Crednef fixed the shaft and the head together with his bronze nails so swiftly that they needed no hammering. Rudan went back to his father and told him what he had seen. In a rage, Bres ordered his son to go and kill the smith. In the meantime, ancient Irish names are really hard to pronounce, had found a mystic spring on the other side of the Plain of Towers, at which stood the Dianchech, god of medicine, with his daughter Ermid at his side. Whenever one of the children of Danu was slain, they were brought to the spring, and Dianchech and his daughter plunged their bodies into the spring, and they re-emerged alive again. In a rage, Bres ordered the destruction of this healing spring. Rudan returned to the forge and asked for a javelin from Goibhniu, the smith god, who gave it to him with no suspicion, thinking that Rudan was one of the children of Danu. No sooner was the weapon in his hand than Rudan turned and cast it at Goibhniu. It went clean through the smith god's body. Mortally wounded as he was, Goibhniu, the smith god, picked up the spear and threw it back, wounding Rudan, who crawled back to his father and died at his feet. The Fomori set up a great keening, which was the first ever heard on the Island of Destiny. Goibhniu also crawled away and came to the spring, where Dianchech and Armid plunged him in, and he emerged healthy and healed. That night, however, the son of Indech and several of his companions came to the spring, and each took a large stone from the bed of a nearby river and dropped it into that spring until they had filled it. So the healing waters were dispersed. Bres, satisfied that the children of Danu were now mortal, and angered by the death of his son, determined that a pitched battle should be fought the next morning. Spears and lances and swords smote against buckler and shield. The whistle of darts and the rattle of arrows and shouting of warriors made it seem as if a great thunder was rolling over the plain of towers. The river Unius, which cut through the plain, was stopped up, so filled was it with dead bodies. The plain was red with blood, so cruel was the battle. Indech of the Fomori fell by the hands of Ogma. And Indech was nor the first nor the last of the leaders of the Fomori to feel the steel of the children of Danu. Neither did the children of Danu go away from that battle unscathed. To the field of slaughter came Balor of the evil eye. I'm not even going to try and pronounce that name. The most formidable of the Fomori champions. He had only one great eye, whose gaze was so malevolent that it destroyed whomsoever looked upon it. So large and awesome was this eye that it took 9 attendants, using hooks, to lift the mighty lid open for Balor. It happened on that fateful day of the battle that Balor came upon Nuadr of the Silver Hand, the leader of the children of Danu, and hard and fierce was their contest. Yet in the end, after shield was shattered, and spear was bent, and sword was broken into pieces, it was the blood of Nuadr, that gushed into the never-ending stream, that gushed in a never-ending stream into the earth of the Island of Blood, Island of Destiny. And not content in this slaughter, Balor turned upon one of Nurda's beautiful wives, Macha, the personification of battles, goddess of warriors, and he slew her also. Nor did Dian Chech, the god of medicine and apothecaries, have the means to restore them to life. At the death of their leader, the children of Danu wavered and became fearful. It was then that Lu Lefada, Lu of the Long Arm, approached the battlefield. Now Lu was the son of Sian, which means the Enduring One, who was in turn the son of Kanait, the god of speech, who was the count. Now the council of the children of Danu had forbidden him to come to the battle, for Lu was all-wise and all-knowledgeable, and it was thought that his life was too valuable to risk in battle, for his was the wisdom needed to serve and save mankind. Indeed, so wise was Lu that Nuada had let him become ruler of the children of Danu for 13 days, in order that they might receive his wisdom. Therefore the children of Danu had imprisoned him, for his own safety, during the battle, with 9 warriors to guard him. But upon hearing that Nuadr was slain, Lu escaped his prison and his guards, and leaping into his chariot, he hurried to join his brothers and sisters on the plain of towers. Bress was standing triumphantly with his Fomori warriors when he saw a great light to the west. "I wonder that the sun is rising in the west today," he muttered, scratching his head. One of the Fomori shamans approached Bress, trembling. "That is not the sun, mighty Bress. That light stems from the countenance of Lu Lamvada. It is his radiance." Lu, with his weapon sheathed, drove his chariot out from the lines of the children of Danu. Straight he drove up to the tightly packed lines of Fomori champions. "Where is Balor?" he cried. "Let he who thinks himself a great warrior come forward and be taught the truth." The lines of Fomori parted, and there the great figure of Balor was seen, seated on a gigantic chair, his mighty one eye closed. Lu's challenge rang out. This time Balor heard it, and said to his attendants, "Lift up my eyelid, that I may gaze upon this prattling little man." The attendants began to lift Balor's eye with a hook. They stood well out of range, for anyone whom that eye fell upon would perish immediately. Lu was ready, though, with a sling, and in it he set the tantalum, a slingshot made of blood mixed with the sand of the swift Armorian sea. As the lid was lifted, Lu hurled his shot into that eye. It struck it, went through the brain and out the back of Balor's head. The great Fomori champion's eye was knocked out and fell onto the ground. In its dying glint, thrice 9 companies of Fomori warriors were destroyed, for they saw its malignant gaze. Balor fell screaming to the ground in blindness, a great anxiety falling upon the Fomori. Lu now raised his sword, and the Morrigans set up a pæan of victory, Kings arise to battle. And so the children of Danu took heart, and echoing the song, they began to move forward. Great was the slaughter now that they pressed back on the children of Domnu. It is said that more Fomori were killed on the plain of towers than there were stars in the sky or grain of sands on the seashore or snowflakes in the winter. And Lu came upon Bress, who was fleeing for his life from the battlefield. "Spare my life, Lu, O great conqueror," cried the son of Eltho, sinking to his knees, for he no longer had the strength nor spirit to fight. "Spare it, and I will pay you whatever ransom you require." "What ransom?" demanded Lu, his sword held at the throat of the Fomori leader. "I will guarantee that there will be no shortage of milk from the cows on this land," offered Bress. Lu then called the children of Danu to him. "What good is that if Bress cannot lengthen the lives of the cows?" they demanded. Bress could no more grant longer lives, so he offered, "If my life is spared, every wheat harvest in this Isle of Destiny will be a good one. We already have good harvesters. We need no other guarantees." Finally, Bress agreed to instruct the children of Danu as to the best times to plow, sow, and reap. And for this knowledge, which they had not, they spared his life. And when the battle was over, when the Fomori were pursued back into their undersea fortress, and they accepted the right of the children of Danu to live in peace in the Isle of Destiny, and to rule over it as gods and goddesses of goodness and light, the Morrigan went to all the summits of the highest mountains of the island, and on each summit she proclaimed the victory of the gods and goddesses of light and goodness. And she sang in triumph, a paean to the mother goddess Danu. "Peace mounts the heavens, the divine waters descend to the earth, and fruitifies our lives. Earth lies under the heavens, we are of the earth now, and everyone is strong." And while Danu smiled over the victory of her children, her sister Domnu scowled from the depths of the earth, and she chose the goddess Bave the Crow as her mouth to utter a prophecy to Danu and her children. "All life is transitory. Even your children are not immortal, my sister. The time will come when they will be defeated. The time will come when no one will want gods and goddesses to nurture them, when they will be driven into the darkness like my children have been this day. The time approaches when the summers of the Isle of Destiny will be flowerless, and when the cows shall be without milk, and the men will be weak, and the women will be shameless. The seas will be without fish, the trees will be without fruit, and old men will give false judgments. The judges will make unjust laws, and honor will count for very little, as warriors will betray each other and resort to thievery. There will come a time when there will be no more virtue left in this world." Indeed, there came a time when the children of Mil flooded into the Isle of Destiny, and when the children of Danu were driven underground into the hills, which were called Sivi, which is pronounced she, so I fucked that up already. And in those mounds they dwelt, the once mighty gods and goddesses, deserted by the very people whom they had sought to nourish. The descendants of Mil, who still live in the Isle of Destiny to this day, called the children of Danu Aes-Shi, the people of the hills. And whenever the religion of Mil was forgotten, when the religion of the cross replaced that of the circle, the people simply called the Aes-Shi the fairies. Of the greatest of the gods, the victor of the Battle of the Plain of Towers, Lu Lanvada, god of all knowledge, patron of all arts and crafts, his name is still known today. But as a memory of the mighty warrior, the invincible god has faded. He is known only as Lu Kroman, little stooping Lu of the sea, of the Shi, regaled to the role of a fairy craftsman. And as even the language in which he was venerated has disappeared, all that is left of the supreme god of the children of Danu is the distorted form of that name, Lucramane, leprechaun.